All right, hello everyone. I am Seema Gupta. Let me introduce myself. I am a professor at IIM Bangalore and I welcome all of you to this live webinar on digital marketing fundamentals. So hello to everyone. I can see Yash and many other people who have joined the webinar. So what do you think? Can I have some comments from you on what do you think about digital marketing? So post your comments. All right, so the agenda that we have for today's webinar, we will discuss what is the digital marketing landscape. We will see what is the targeting that is possible in digital marketing. We will analyze the content strategy that you can adopt for digital marketing. We will have a look at what is the consumer decision-making journey and how digital marketing can be mapped to different stages of the consumer decision journey. And at the end of the webinar, you'll be able to prepare a digital marketing plan. So, all right, we have some interesting comments which are coming from Yash. He's saying digital marketing is a method of advertising our business online to our potential customers. And Mahipal is saying digital marketing is about promoting your product to reach the target audience who are there on the online platform. Yes, that's so true. Digital marketing is all about reaching your intended target audience, and it is all about doing things online. So that gives us a good start. So what is the digital marketing landscape? So when we say digital marketing landscape, there are host of platforms and there are lots of buckets in which we can categorize the different aspects of digital marketing. The number one bucket we have is the search engines. So we have somebody saying not able to hear anything. So I will try to be louder. So the first aspect we have in digital marketing is the search engines. So you have Google or Bing or Yahoo and so many search engines. So what is so unique about these search engines and what is the value that they add? So can you quickly type in comments? So what is the uniqueness of search engines? Why search engines are called as platforms for customer acquisition? They are very good at customer acquisition because when the consumer is typing in a query in the search engine, that means the consumer already has an intent or interest in the product. Okay. So the consumer already has an intent or interest in the product or service. So when our ads or organic links are shown in the search engine, these people are more likely to click. And chances of people spending some time on the website, filling a lead form, and people converting are always much higher. So search engines are called platforms for customer acquisition because they tap into the consumer intent and the consumer interest. So these are the pull mediums. They are not push mediums. They are pull mediums. Now, another bucket that we can look at from digital marketing point of view is the publishers like YouTube or Yahoo or India Times. So what is the strength of these publishers? Can anybody, would you like to put some comments on this? So why these publishers, they are called as good platforms for brand building? What is so unique about these publishing platforms? So they are very good for brand building because number one objective in brand building is to create awareness. And for creating awareness, one needs good reach. And these platforms, They have millions of unique users and millions of page views per month. Exactly. So we have Nikita and Harshit who are saying that these publishers are very good for brand building because they help you maximize reach, which is very true. And the benefit of these platforms is that they are push platforms. So you can really push out your brand messages in front of your target audience and create awareness and tell what your product and service stands for. The third bucket that we can look at digital marketing is the social media platforms like LinkedIn or Facebook. So would you want to guess what is the highlight or the strength of social media? How is it different from search engine? So when we say LinkedIn or Facebook, they are very good at building a community. They help in fostering engagement. So they are very good platforms for retaining your existing customers. Yes, Anil is saying they are very good because they provide the network effect. So you have a lot of friends on Facebook, and if the target audience likes something, then they can share, they can like, they can comment. And so it fosters a lot of interactivity and engagement with your community. Do you want to guess how Twitter is different from Facebook? So I want to see some comments about unique characteristics of Twitter. Why microblogging sites, they are called to be very good for information dissemination. Why not Facebook considered as a platform for information dissemination? If you see Twitter, in Twitter, anyone can follow anybody. So there is no restriction. It is an open network. On Facebook, you have to send a friend request and the other person has to accept the friend request. Then only communication will happen within the network. But in Twitter, you can follow anybody and you can go to the profile of any person and see all the tweets. And of course, so we have some interesting comments coming from people. Shivangi is saying, Yash is saying that hashtags are very popular on Twitter. And that is so very true because hashtags help in virality. And because people can search and people can follow hashtags, so it's very easy for things to really become very viral and get that network effect on Twitter. Moreover, the limited characters which are possible to be used on Twitter, the brevity of Twitter makes it more amenable to virality. Yes, apart from that, a lot of celebrities and influencers are on Twitter. So when they post content on Twitter and when their followers, they retweet, the virality is much more. So what do you think about online reputation management, which is the next building block of the digital landscape? So digital is so unique because here marketers do not have control on their messaging. So users are free, they can comment, they can write anything, they can ventilate their views, they can share their experiences. So because of these factors, the reputation of the company can sometimes be at risk. So one big challenge in digital marketing is how do we manage the online reputation? And have you heard of tools like say Radian6 or Simplify 360 or Sysmos? So there are a plethora of tools. These are all listening tools. And these tools, they help in identifying what is the consumer sentiment. So is there a negative attitude or is there a positive attitude towards the brand? What are the brand associations? and they can be used to mitigate the risks which are there to the online reputation. So as a brand marketer, it is good to know how consumers are thinking about your brand and quickly respond to them so that any grievance is redressed in real time. And when grievances are addressed satisfactorily, then these consumers, they become more loyal towards the brand. So digital is a wonderful platform for managing your online reputation and foster loyalty. Yeah, so Pratibha is asking an interesting question. Will it not be an intrusion to privacy? And Yash is saying, no, digital is not an intrusion to privacy because digital is also offering us so many benefits. So there is a lot of tracking which is happening on digital. So cookies are being placed on websites and they are tracking how you are behaving online, which websites you are visiting, and they are preparing profiles of people. But rest assured, these are all anonymous. So they cannot say that this person is Seema Gupta or Yash Raj or anybody else. So these are all anonymized. And moreover, most of the websites, they make a disclosure that cookies are placed in the browser of the user. Moreover, also see the advantages that we are getting from digital. So much of the content is free. Now, many people are not subscribing to newspapers because people are getting content on social media. People are getting content on news sites. So when people are getting content for free, we have to, see those ads which are basically paying for the content. And some cookies are dropped, but they are anonymous. So the last bucket we have for digital landscape is your digital analytics. So there are a lot of tools like Web Trends or Google Analytics, and they track and they tell that how many people engaged, how many people went to the site, what is the bounce rate, what is the conversion rate, and so on. Okay, so now we move to the next agenda in our webinar, which is about targeting. So can you identify what are the methods by which we can do targeting on digital marketing? And how is it different from the targeting which is done on traditional media? Targeting is one of the strengths of digital marketing. It is very, very sophisticated. It is becoming more and more advanced. So we have some interesting question from Shaikh, who's saying, what are the best strategies to promote software services on social media? And can he use emotional strategies? So Shaikh, software services are very apt for digital marketing because software services are very high involvement, and digital is very apt when people are cognitively, mentally, more involved, when the risks are higher and purchase decision requires more involvement, and software services fall in that category. So people will actually go to the search engine, they will find out what options are available, they will compare, they will look for ratings, reviews, and so on. So digital is very apt for it. So targeting is very precise, as Anoop is saying, in digital marketing. That is so very true, Anoop. In digital, there is no wastage. In fact, the only thing in digital is that you correctly can identify that who's your target audience. So is it male or female? They belong to which age group? Which location they live in? What are their interests? What are their online behaviors? And are they existing customers or are they new customers? What type of device they are using? So are they using smartphones, within smartphone, Do they use Apple or do they use Android and so on? So like Mahipal is saying, targeting can be done through interest. So that's actually the power of social media, that you can do a lot of interest-based targeting. So Facebook exactly knows what are your likes through the pages that you have liked, the content that you post, the content that you engage with, and the interest that you have put up in your profile. LinkedIn exactly knows what are your skills. It knows your interest based on the job title that you have, the functional area that you are working in. And Google knows that what are your interests by seeing the websites that you are currently visiting. So if I am constantly visiting different websites of digital camera, like say Nikon or Canon, then Google can infer that my short-term interest is to buy a digital camera. And they can show me ads for digital camera. So in traditional advertising, marketers, they don't know what is going waste. There is a saying that half the advertising is waste, but the problem is we don't know which half. But in digital, there's no wastage. So you're not reaching out to unintended audiences. So targeting is only very specific, very precise. We have interesting question from Reddy, who's saying, how do we track authenticity of digital advertising? So are they authentic or are they not authentic? See, digital is evolving, and there is a possibility of lot of fraud to happen on digital marketing. But these, for example, click fraud. So you can have bots or you can have click farms where people can be manually just clicking, and you get an impression that, okay, a lot of people are clicking on your ads. Whereas some people may be paid to click on the ads, or there may be some bots or some malware may be installed in the computer. And this malware is controlling your computer and taking it to the websites and clicking on ads. But nowadays, a lot of development has happened to curb all these click frauds. So if a lot of clicks are coming from same IP address, or if clicks are coming from odd geographies or at odd times of the day, then those clicks can be identified as fraudulent clicks. So coming back to targeting, so the forte of digital marketing, one of the highlights is your remarketing. So suppose you must have seen that if you go to Amazon and you don't buy a product, then you keep on seeing Amazon and that product ads wherever you go on the web. So whether you are on Facebook or whether you are on some other sites on the web, you keep on seeing those ads repeatedly. So that is called as remarketing, and it is a very powerful method of targeting, because the consumer has already shown an interest, and the consumer is more likely to buy. And so when you show the ads to that consumer on the web or on social media, the chances of conversion are much higher. Can you guess what is this lookalike modeling? This is one of the latest methods of targeting on digital marketing, and it will be a game changer. So lookalike is very fascinating. How does it work? Is basically you upload your own database. So it can be database of people who have visited your website, It can be database of people who have filled a registration form, or who have taken a test drive, or who have downloaded an e-paper, or who have attended a webinar. And then ads can be basically shown to people who are similar to these audiences. So people who have already engaged with you, they are your best customers. They are your best target audiences. And if you can target people who are similar to them in profile, that targeting will be more effective and it will give a higher ROI, return on investment. So watch out. Write in comments if you have heard about lookalike modeling and lookalike targeting. So we have Mian Kini, who is asking a question that if targeting is very specific, when I run Facebook ads for my brand page on Facebook, then why do I get likes from people who are not my target audience? So valid question. So it depends on how well we have understood our consumers. So if we understand our consumers very well, and we understand their demographics, their psychographic, and their interest, and the device that they use, then we can put proper targeting in Facebook. So my recommendation to you would be to see if a particular targeting is not working, and you're getting likes from people who are not exactly your target audience, then tweak your targeting a little bit and see if you're getting better results subsequently. So we have a question from Vinay, who's asking that which websites offer lookalike targeting. So you have lookalike targeting. Basically all platforms of digital marketing, they offer lookalike targeting. So you can do lookalike targeting on Facebook, you can do lookalike targeting on Google AdWords, and for that you can use data management platforms. So this is the latest kid on the block, and they provide, they enrich your target audience data so that it has complete profile. So you know not just the email ID and phone number, but you also know the psychographics, you know the interest of people, and you know what websites they are visiting, and so on. All right, so we'll move to the next agenda for today's webinar. So what do you think about content strategy? What type of content you think will help you in furthering your digital marketing objectives? So I would like to see some comments from the attendees on the content strategy that can be adopted for digital marketing. So there are some interesting frameworks that you can use to devise your content strategy. So number one framework is you can have 50-50 content strategy. So what is this 50-50? So 50-50 means that not more than 50% of the content should be about your brand and your company. So remaining 50% of the content should be general interest content. So beyond the point, your target audience is not interested in only hearing about your product or service. So it is good to engage them with content which is more broad in appeal. Then there is, so we have some interesting insights which are coming from Shaik and Anoop, who are saying that you should avoid the duplication of content, which is so very true. Your content has to be unique. So if you are only copying and pasting the content which already exists somewhere on internet or on social media, then there's nothing unique, there is nothing novel about the content. And so target audience will be less motivated to engage with your content. So try to keep it original, keep it relevant, and keep it unique. Another thing is it has to be well differentiated, rise above the clutter. So Anoop, this is exactly what my second point is. So this framework of 70-20-10 talks about breaking the clutter and differentiating the content. So 70% of the content can basically be your routine content. So it is the everyday post that you are putting up on Facebook, the tweets that you are doing on a daily basis. So it is your routine, hygiene, content. 20% of your content should be medium risk content. So there is some risk involved because you are increasing the creativity, and hence it may or may not appeal to the target audience, because the higher the risk, higher the reward, but there is also a chance of failure. So for example, we have this like Micro Max. When they had launched their phone, which was Micro Max Unite, they basically focused on creating a content which was a piece of music. And they used a popular A.R. Rahman music, and they converted it into a sort of vernacular music. So why they did that? Because the phone had vernacular capabilities. So to highlight that in the phone you can basically text and you can message in multiple languages. So they created a content which was a popular A.R. Rahman song sung by many artists and stitched together. And this piece of content was put up on YouTube, and it became a trending music video on YouTube during Independence Day. So this is an example of 20% of content which is higher risk. Now, 10% of your content should be very high risk. Now, why it is high risk? Because you are further improving and increasing the creativity quotient of your content. And so higher the creativity, the higher are the chances that it may not click with your target audience. I'm sure many of you are familiar with Red Bull, and Red Bull came up with a campaign which is Red Bull Stratos, and this was about space jump. And this event was organized, and live telecast of this event was done on YouTube. Now, this was a very risky content strategy, because you're talking about somebody doing a space jump in order to see whether the person can break the record of speed of sound. And there is a huge risk you are taking. You may not be able to break the record, or there may be some accident because you are doing space jump. So life is at risk. So this is an example of 10% risky content. So creative content is a risk. How? That is what Nitin is asking. So that's what Nitin, we are discussing, that see, in digital, the cost of failure is low. So it is always good to take some risk on digital. So you raise the bar, you increase your creativity quotient, and that is how you are taking risk. It may or may not appeal to the target audience, so it may or may not succeed. So we'll move on to the next framework that we have for content strategy. So would you want to guess what is this three framework? So we have this question from Dubai. So Deep Snehal is asking, can I explain 70-20-10 again? So Deep Snehal, I would recommend I think recording and archive of this webinar may be available. So maybe you can look at it again, or we can engage subsequent to this webinar to chat about it. Okay, so any guesses? What is this three framework? So what is E stand for? What does E stand for? So E is either you excite your target audience, or you educate your target audience, or you entertain your target audience. So the content strategy should be either excite, entertain, or educate. So either talk about the passion points of your target audience, so the genres that they are interested in, that they are passionate about, or educate them. So maybe break some of the myths that they are having, or give them some hacks, or give them some tips, or tell them how they can use your product, or give any useful information that they can use to make purchase decisions. So educate is one. Another is either entertain or excite. So people don't come to social media only for education purposes, right? So you go to Facebook to entertain yourself, to see what's happening, to keep up to date. So that can be another content strategy. So entertain people or excite people. So you should be able to inspire people, and you should make them feel connected and get them to create content which resonates with them. So here, maybe I can just give a pause and see if there are some more questions which are there. So I would strongly encourage you to post some questions and write some comments which we can discuss. So we have Arjuna. So very good comment coming from Arjuna that usability of content is very important. So precisely, Arjuna, that is what we discussed, that content should either educate or entertain people, or it should excite. So if it is not adding any value to your target audience, then it will be futile. And if there is no value addition from the content, then people will not engage or pay attention to your content. We have some more people I can take. Hitesh is saying, it's important to create buzz on social media. It's important to create buzz. So that's so very true. Social media is all about using the power of your network and creating the virality. So for creating buzz, either the content has to be emotional, or it can be provocative, or it can be a little bit two-sided. So instead of making a statement, you ask a question. And when you ask a question, people give opinions. And that makes the content engaging. And putting something which is novel, which people have not seen, which is different. So we have Shaikh who's asking, will entertain or excite strategy work out for every industry? Yes, I would think so. So even if you're a very serious company, say a B2B company or a software service company or real estate or in education, entertain or excite is very important. Because that is the mood of people when they come to social media. They are basically taking a break from the humdrum of daily life. And they are surfing Facebook and social media while they are taking a break from their job. So it's important to entertain and educate. We have an interesting question from Sandeep. Who's asking, how do you measure the ROI of digital marketing? So very interesting and very relevant question. So, Sandeep, the strength of digital is that it's highly measurable. So you have lot of metrics in digital marketing, and you exactly know that how many people have seen an ad. You exactly can identify how many people have engaged. So your metric for social media can be engagement rate. Your metric for ads can be click-through rate. Your metrics can be that how many page views or how many unique users came to the site. And you can measure how much time they spent on the site. And this is not enough. So you should also see that what is the business outcome? So what is the conversion rate? And what is the average order value? So you should have a combination of metrics, which is click stream, and another set of metrics which are related to business outcomes. So let's move on. We have many more comments which have come in. We will address them as we move forward. So the next aspect that we want to touch upon in this webinar is the consumer decision-making journey. So some of you who are from marketing, you may be familiar with the IDA model. So IDA stands for awareness, interest, desire, and action. So these are the different stages that the consumers, they go through. So first of all, you have to tell the consumer that you exist, and this is your brand, and this is what you stand for. But simple awareness is not enough. So as marketers, we have to stimulate interest in the target audience for our product and service. So we have to get them interested so that they want to find out more about our products and services. Then we have to create a desire wherein consumers form preference towards our product or service. And ultimately, we want people to buy our products and services. So I want to ask the participants that out of all these stages, which one do you think digital marketing is very good at? So is it good at creating awareness? Is it good at interest or desire or action or advocacy? Please punch in your responses. Okay, so if we see and if we compare with traditional marketing, see, traditional marketing is only good at creating awareness. So you advertise on TV and a lot of people, they come to know about your brand. But it is not good at action. It is not good at helping people compare, evaluate. So we have Pinakin who's saying digital is very good at awareness. Now, which platforms of digital are good at creating awareness, Pinakin? So which platforms of digital are good at creating interest? So punch in your responses. But if you, so mass media is very good at creating awareness. If you look at, say, personal selling, that's very good at action. So you have your own sales force and they can precisely tell the target audience that what is the strength of your product and why they should buy your products and services. So most of the platforms of traditional media, they are good at only one aspect of the consumer funnel. But the strength of digital is that it is good for all the stages of the consumer journey. So it is good at creating awareness, interest, desire, action, as well as advocacy. So can you tell which platforms are good for creating interest? Which platforms are good for desire? See, awareness can be created by doing display ads on Facebook, putting up banner ads on YouTube. Why? Because these platforms, they have huge reach. They have millions of unique users, millions of page views. How will you create interest? So one can create interest, one can create desire by getting ratings, reviews, by influencer marketing, blogger outreach, or question answer platforms like Quora, or community forums, or blogs. Because they are helping in comparison, they are helping in evaluation. So you should have things like ROI calculator on your website or a comparison tool. So people can use these tools to analyze and make informed decisions. And of course, you can take action, which means you can basically buy by going to a e-commerce site or an aggregator site. So if you don't have an e-commerce site of your own, you can make a purchase decision, say for financial products on Bank Bazaar or Policy Bazaar. Or you, if you are looking in the market for buying an automobile, you can go to many car portals. So it can be Car Deco or Team BHP and so on. So do you want to identify what is the relevance of advocacy for digital marketing? So we have Manish who's saying best content marketing has been done by Amazon when they launched OnePlus by engaging customer through quiz on the phone specifications. Yes, that's a very interesting example. So when you do a quiz, basically it's interactive. And if there is a gratification, so people are motivated to participate and answer. So social media can create a lot of engagement. So we have many more interesting comments coming from testimonials can be done through advocacy. Yes. Mahipal, that's so very true. In fact, digital has brought advocacy to the mainstream. So it's become important what the consumer experiences after the purchase. So consumers now have platform of social media where they can share their experiences, they can ventilate their grievances, and they can get their customer service issues addressed. So advocacy has become very important only because of digital marketing. And so brands don't have to blow their own trumpet, and they can use their existing customers to become the brand ambassadors. And they can basically use the ratings or reviews or the case studies or testimonials in order to influence and bring credibility to their entire product or service value proposition. So advocacy was an underdog and was not considered that important amongst all the stages of the consumer buying journey. But digital has really brought it to limelight, and a lot of subtle marketing can be done through advocacy. So let us quickly see if there are any more. Yeah, so we have a lot of questions coming in from people, participants. And thank you for interacting and keeping it so much alive. So we have some more facets of digital marketing to cover. So we have Anup who's saying advocacy would be like creating a vote bank and reputation management will be involved. So that's a very good it's a very good metaphor to use. So advocacy is like creating your own vote bank because you have people who are basically voting for you, and when you have consumers voting for you, then it's more credible, it's more authentic, it's more believable. We have interesting question coming from Pavan, who's saying, any course necessary for content writing. It is from Shaikh, who's saying any course necessary for content writing. Of course, there are a lot of materials which are available in the market, and you can also refer to the book which elaborates the three framework and the content writing part. You can also look at HubSpot, which elaborates and gives you a lot of tutorials on content marketing. I recall one of the participants had recommended that you should use an active voice, and you should have only one messaging at a point in time. So your messaging should be very clear, crisp, not too many messages, one message at a point in time, and reinforce your messaging so that people completely understand the message. And your content writing will be very good if you are tailoring it to the target audience. So when you understand the consumer pain point, and then you create content which is of use to them, then it will be more effective. So let's move on to another aspect of our digital marketing fundamentals. And in fact, this is the last leg. So what do you think? How will you go about creating a digital marketing plan? What do you think are the components of a digital marketing plan? So I would be happy to see some comments which can come in for creating a digital marketing plan, or some questions that you have. So this is all about digital marketing strategy. So what are the components? Number one aspect of digital marketing plan is identifying the objective. So Harshit is saying, you must identify and define the business goal. And this is exactly what we are talking about. You should identify the business objective. So can you identify what are the two objectives every marketing has to fall into? So one objective can be branding. So your objective is to create awareness, or your objective is to build top of mind recall, or build a favorable attitude. Another objective could be performance. So here, your objective is to get orders, your objective is to get revenues, your objective is to build bottom line for the company. And hence the metrics would be click rate, conversion rate, and so on. The second part or the second step in preparing a digital marketing plan is the buyer persona. So here, it's important to identify your target audience upfront. So who is the target audience? And look at real data, look at your existing customers, and identify their demographics. So what age group they belong to, what is the gender, what job title they have, and build personas. So it is not that your complete target audience is homogeneous. So build at least 5 or 6 personas. So different personas, and build a pen profile for each persona. So identify who they are, identify what do they spend their time upon, and what are their interests, and what are their pain points, and what are their areas of passion. So talk to your target audience and get insights into each of these facets. Understand the why of consumer behavior. So why will the target audience buy your product? So what is your elevator pitch? How will you convince your target audience in just 2 minutes? The third step in preparing a digital marketing plan is preparing a content strategy. So again, it's very important to look at your historic data. So what has worked for you in the past? So have videos been more effective, or have images been more effective, or has the target audience interacted more with infographics or ebooks or webinars or educational content or entertainment content? So try and analyze and see what content strategy works for you. This next aspect of digital marketing plan is your channel strategy. So one must analyze that what is the paid media that you want to use, how much of owned media you want to use, and how much of earned. So can you quickly tell that is Facebook a paid media or owned or earned? So what is it? So give your comments in the comment box. So paid, owned, earned media, how much you want to allocate budget where? So will your focus be more on paid media, or will your focus be more on owned and earned media? So a quick thumb rule that we can adopt is that if you are starting and if you are a new brand, then you can allocate more budget on paid media. But if you are an established company and your brand already has many customers, then you can allocate more budget on owned and earned media. So yes, we have Shalaka and Hirsch. They are saying Facebook is an earned media. So what it is earning is very right. It is earning likes, shares, and comments. But Hirsch, it's not just earned media. It's basically all three. So Facebook is also a paid media because you can run paid ads on Facebook. It's also an owned media because you own the Facebook page, or you own the Twitter handle, and you own the content, the intellectual property right of the content that you create for Facebook. So it is all three. After that, you must prepare a calendar, a timeline. So month-wise, how money will be spent and what activities will be carried out. And then budget needs to be allocated. So how much budget you want to allocate within paid on search, how much budget within paid on display, and on within social media. What is your focus platform? So do you want to focus on Facebook, or will you focus on LinkedIn, and so on? How much money will you spend on creating content? So the manpower that you will hire, how much money you will spend on tech development cost? You may want to create a microsite, or you may want to develop a custom application or a custom tab for Facebook. So the technological cost, and in the end, your digital marketing plan should identify the metrics. So if your objectives are branding, your metrics will be very different as compared to the metrics that you will use when your objectives are performance oriented. So can you quickly guess what metrics are relevant for branding campaigns, and what metrics are relevant for performance campaigns? So if it is branding, you can look at top of mind recall, or how many impressions, or how many clicks. But if it is performance campaign, you are basically looking at how many people filled the lead form. So what is the lead rate? How many people bought? What is the conversion rate? And what is the average order value? So Harshit is saying, very rightfully Harshit said, that CPM, cost per 1,000 impressions, is the metric that you will use for branding. And Nitin is saying leads is what you will use for performance. So that's so very true. Engagement is a metric when your objective is branding. So that's very interesting and very apt. So we have Rasul who's saying, we have a question from Rasul. how can we trace the influence of information overload on buyers in present digital age? Rasool, this is very interesting. This is so very true. Because of digital, we are all loaded with lots of information, and there is a cognitive load on the minds of people. So as a digital marketer, we should simplify things and guide people to the right source depending upon the stage of the funnel they are in. So if somebody is in interest stage, you should guide them to a blog. But if somebody doesn't know about your product or service, you should just guide them to the home page or basically your Facebook page. So we have we can take some more questions, and I open it up to Q&A. Before that, so whatever fundamentals we have discussed about digital marketing in today's webinar, you will find all of this and a lot more in this book on digital marketing, which is published by McGraw, and you can buy it from Flipkart, Amazon, and even from McGraw Hill site. And you can avail the coupon code and get up to 25% discount from the link which is shared with you in this webinar. So it has interesting questions, and this book is a good blend of theory and practice. So whether you are a student or you are a professional already practicing digital marketing, you will have a lot of examples, case studies, and frameworks which are there in the book on this digital. And it has very good visualization. So you will see a lot of examples, you will see a lot of pictures, a lot of flow diagrams, and a lot of smart art, which will help you visualize and relate to the content. So we can open up the platform for some more question answers. So we have this question from, are there any more webinars coming up? So maybe we'll keep you posted. Pinakin is asking, are there any more webinars? Certainly we can do more webinars, and we'll keep you informed. We'll post it on social media. So how do you make the content go viral? Harshit is asking. So in fact, Harshit, everybody wants to make their content become viral. And in fact, if anybody is able to crack this, then that person will be the most sought after digital marketer. So maybe you should try and crack and find answer to this question. And I'm sure you'll be the most sought after digital marketer. But some quick tips on making your content viral. So as I said earlier, using little bit of emotional appeal and little bit of dramatization, some provocation, or using something which is trending. So if everybody is Olympics is going on, and if you create content around Olympics, or if IPL is going on, and if you create content around IPL, it has more possibility of trending rather than having an inward focused approach. So we have another question. Is digital marketing recognized by Government of India Education Department? So Shaikh, we all know how savvy Modi government is in using digital and social media, and this entire demonetization and encouraging people to use wallets and e-payments and so on. So definitely there is a lot of thrust, and we have Digital India, this entire project by the Government of India for Digital India. There is a lot of thrust. So this is a very good option for making a career. So if you are young and you're looking for career possibilities and avenues, digital marketing is a very interesting career option. Shall we take one last question? We will take one last question before we close this webinar. What platforms you suggest for B2B marketing? B2B marketing can heavily use search engine marketing because it's high involvement. So people are searching, they are typing in queries. B2B marketing should utilize blogs. So you should educate people how they can use their products, your products, and how they can arrive at purchase decisions. Ratings, reviews, and LinkedIn is a very relevant social media platform for B2B marketing. Yes, the book covers strategies and lots of examples on B2B marketing, and have a look at it, pick it up. I strongly recommend the book for B2C as well as B2B marketing. So with this, we can bring the webinar to a conclusion. Thank you so much for being here and for attending the webinar. Please do key in your comments and so on, and look forward to interacting with you again in future. Thank you.